we've been talking about the extent to which the enthusiasm for impact investing that we've heard so much about today, you know, is this now hardwired into the financial system, and you know, or are the change in the political winds going to blow it off track again? And I particularly want to ask, you know, post COP21, there was a real sense of momentum around climate change financing in particular. Is that momentum being maintained, or is it now abruptly stopping because we all think Trump is going to, you know, sort of go back to coal in a big way, or whatever?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's an important question, and I think both going forward and actually looking back. I think going forward, you know, I got asked this question the other day, and I thought about it for a while, and I guess I had three main things to respond. I think one is, at the end of the day, the core drivers of interest in ESG and impact investing are strong, resilient, and feels like a powerful secular trend. And whether the election changes the angle from this to this or stays the same, the broad trajectory is still profound. And I think as an index of that, I was calculating, you know, in the first 2 months of this year, we've invested three times as much money as we did in the 8 years of existence of Imprint Capital in impact and ESG, right? So just to the sense of the volume, the scale is ramping up, and that feels like a secular trend that is above and beyond the election, number one. I think, you know, number two, the election for some people has been a call to action, right? Some people, it's been a motivator. We have talked to other peers. They've gotten calls from clients where this has led them to think about using a broader toolkit around issues that they care about. So some people have been made nervous as they wonder what the policy regime brings, but some, it's been a call to action. Third, when you look at the policy regime, as with any investment topic, and certainly ESG and impact investing, you have to get past the headline and beneath the surface. Because broadly, if you look at public markets, there was a pullback, renewable energy, bad. You know, you look at the rhetoric and the headlines. But getting beneath the surface, okay, what is driven by federal policy that is likely to change? What is not driven by, what's already driven by markets? You know, coal is arguably a market-driven story, not a policy-driven story. Renewable power is a state policy-driven story. Federal ITC has been extended, a lot of wind in red states. So if you get beneath the surface, as you need to do with any topic, you have a more nuanced, fine-grained view, and it's sort of less of a one-way bet. Broad headlines are what they are, but when you get to the task of investing, it's a more granular process.
So, Nora, is that your experience as well? Is that what you're seeing?
Yeah, and I would agree with what John said, and I think you know, one of the things that we had talked about was green bonds in the context of this panel, and I think to the point that John is making around secular trends, I think that's a really good example of a secular trend towards not just an interest in impact investing and integrating ESG, but also the mainstreaming of the market. So it's a great example because
you know, and just give us the numbers on green bonds.
Sure, $96 billion was issued last year. It was almost double the previous year. You know, I think what's interesting.
And they are, just again, explain.
Oh, sure. Yeah, of course. So the thing that's interesting about green bonds is truly they are just plain vanilla bonds in which the issuer has pledged the use of the proceeds to at business activities or investments that relate to environmental sustainability. And the space has evolved to where the expectation is now that issuers and underwriters should be extremely clear about what those, you know, what the capital raise is being directed to. And the reason why that's an interesting example, and it's a great example of what John is talking about in terms of secular trends, is because the space is growing and the uptake has been really impressive. And if we look out a year, 2 years, we already have massive commitments, especially from governments who are talking about using green bonds as a way of meeting their commitments under COP21, COP22. And so, you know, we're actually seeing a very mainstream instrument being used in order to advance impact in the financial markets. Now, what I would say as a caveat is that that digging into sort of the, you know, the genetic material of markets and institutions hasn't really happened yet. So, you know, it's great to have a plain vanilla instrument, but you know, if I was going to refer back to, for instance, what Brian Trelstad said during his presentation, he was talking about impact fidelity and reporting standards and a link between returns and sustainability. And I think this is a great example of mainstreaming, but we're not quite there with these instruments, for instance. There's still a long way to go in terms of how instruments like green bonds can really advance the space, because it's just, you're just investing in the balance sheet of the same entity that you would have invested in with another plain vanilla bond that's not called a green bond.
Well, we'll come back and talk about that some more, but your basic message is that there's no sign of this being blown off course by the political situation. Mark, are you of that view as well?
Lansard Brothers, they did a report just a short while ago that the last 7 years the price of solar PV has dropped by 85%. So this is basic economics. It's if we're in the middle of a technological revolution, in the middle of an energy revolution, from high carbon to low carbon, to some extent policy is going to influence it. But on the basis of economics, we're at the stage now in many parts of the world where solar is cheaper to build than coal, and importantly in the developing world where they're still building new energy infrastructure, wind is competitive. Our estimates at Carbon Tracker is the take-up of electric vehicles is going to be much, much faster than people anticipate. Why? It's getting cost competitive. And the other reason is a better driving experience. People want to drive a Tesla. People like the cleaner experience. So this is not going to get pushed off course by anything that might happen in a regime change.
So I want to, on the one end, we have this macro political change going on, which we're not worried about, at least in this respect, of what it will do to the climate finance. At the other end, there's this grassroots political movement going on, which is just saying, divest, get out of carbon. That seems to have, in some ways, a lot more passion even than we're seeing associated with impact investing. What do you think of that movement, John?
I mean, it's been fascinating. Obviously, Mark and Carbon Tracker have had a very interesting role in history in that process. And I think back to this idea of when we think about what that's accomplished, you know, and we have clients across the spectrum. Everybody asks, what's our house view on divestment? And it's very simple, clear, and definitive. Organizations should make the right choice for the right reasons and implement well. And because there is a lot of facile argument for and against these, and there's a lot of very unnuanced conversations on the impact side and on the investment side. I think getting a little deeper to a more nuanced conversation is important. However, in some ways, the crisp simplicity of the divestment movement has what has made it a potent rallying cry that raises the question. It doesn't necessarily answer the question, but it raises it, and it's had a power to raise the question that I think we've seen be quite constructive, even though the paths organizations take are quite diverse. And it's one of the tasks with all of these efforts. Green bonds is another great example. You start with something that's simple, clear, and feels actionable and crisp in a way to get started. Reality is messy and complicated and nuanced and evolving and growing. That's not a great way to inspire people to get started. It's messy, it's really hard, it's ambiguous, good luck, right? And so in some ways, you need to almost definitionally oversimplify to get people to engage with the longer, less romantic slog of actually doing the work. And I think we've seen Divest has been one of those constructive rallying cries to get people into the process of doing the work, even though it unfolds in a variety of
ways. And I suppose it was interesting how quickly they became Divest Invest rather than just Divest. And I suppose that starts to get you into your more nuanced.
Because once again, the real task is, how do you think about and understand risk and opportunity from climate across a portfolio, right? And that's more nuanced. And it's not just about fossil fuel companies. It's not just about avoid. It's, you know, it's a much more nuanced task. But you can't start with that as the pitch. That does not fit on a postcard, right? You need to start with something that gets people engaged. But then that's the beginning and not the end of the conversation.
Mark, so talk us through, I mean, your Carbon Tracker's contribution to this Divest Invest debate.
Yeah, I see you got this Twitter at Carbon Bubble. I mean, what we did is a few years ago now, just some basic maths, and it's something that struck me working in fund management for many years, that we knew about the science of climate. We knew that more emissions led to higher atmospheric concentrations of CO2 that led us towards this 2 degrees direction, which beyond that is, you know, we're into the unknown. The basic maths was that myself and a couple of colleagues, we took the world's top 200 coal, oil, and gas companies. We looked at the reserves and the resources and said how much CO2 is in there. Now, if Exxon and Shell and the others get to develop their businesses, which is what they're telling Wall Street that they are going to do, and all that CO2 gets released, they've got enough there to take us to 4 degrees of warming. So that we coined the phrase the carbon bubble, not that we thought necessarily that there would be huge financial implications to this, but more that there was far too much carbon out there that everyone was intent on developing and extracting. That's the core thesis of the carbon bubble. Bill McKibben, this American, went on and read our research. We printed 100 copies. For some reason, one copy got into Naomi Klein's hand, who then gave it to Bill McKibben. He wrote this article in Rolling Stone magazine about the basic numbers, and he did his do the math tour. And then all of a sudden, people got excited by this, and that led to the divestment movement. And the report, which was launched in December, just a few months ago, there's now $5.3 trillion of institutions have committed to divest, either to completely exit coal or to get out of oil and gas as well. And the important thing is the invest part of it. What I'm surprised by, because when you think about the numbers and the math, it's pretty obvious. It was an easy piece of research to do. Why was it a not-for-profit group of ex-Wall Street analysts, fund managers, which is, you know, the people in my team, there's sort of 17 of us now doing this research. Why did it take a not-for-profit to kind of state the obvious? And how come Wall Street, with the best analytical firms and all these fund managers out there paid, you know, their millions of dollars of bonuses, how was it that they missed something which is a fairly obvious piece of math? And what was interesting for me about the divestment movement is when, if you look at it, they don't pose it necessarily as a moral issue, though it is for some people. They're posing it as a financial risk issue, where we're told our job, and I worked in fund management for 20 years, is to manage risk. And how many times I hear about risk-adjusted returns? And here we've got the biggest risk of all, which is climate and climate change and runaway climate change, and we didn't have the analytics to get our arms around this problem. And the divestment movement certainly got people focused on this, and Schroders and UBS and all these other sophisticated fund management companies or investment banks are now producing terrific analysis where they use our phrase unburnable carbon, stranded assets, the carbon bubble, and it's now sort of now into the main kind of dialogue and perspective. You know, it's with Mark Carney and Mayor Bloomberg with their task force on climate risk that took hold of this stranded assets climate risk challenge, I think has become very much a mainstream issue, and I'm sure it has for your clients as well.
And where do you see that going, the Carney-Bloomberg work?
Well, the task force reports in July under the G20 for the Financial Stability Board. I think there's a lot of interest behind it, a lot of momentum. It now comes down to whether the central banks and the regulators want to implement it. There is one of my heroes is Davy Jones, the Californian Insurance Commissioner, who has now been writing to the insurance companies, challenging them why they're invested in the coal industry, asking them if they're taking on the risks. And so you've got little pockets of insights and experts. The Sustainable Stock Exchange Initiative, I think with major stock exchanges involved in it. It's got a long way to travel. My worry is that at an event like this, there's a bit of choice here, which is, well, if you don't want to do the green stuff, there's the conventional stuff. There is a fossil-free fund over here. And somehow this particular risk, climate risk, has been keyholed into any other ethical issue like tobacco or arms. And it's about some kind of choice that you're making, when actually this is a risk which is going to hit all markets. The energy transition isn't going to be isolated to just the greenies who think it's material. It's going to affect everyone. And what I'm really pointing to is a question of materiality. If we think this is an investment issue and it's a data-driven issue and it's a science-driven issue, then it's something for everybody, not just for the kind of diehards in the corner.
There's an interesting challenge for the task force. So Bloomberg hosted, we had a breakfast in San Francisco that Curtis convened. And at the end of it, I said, I appreciate the challenge. I don't know that I have great guidance, but I appreciate the challenge you're wrestling with, which is back to that lens of materiality, which is, and something Bloomberg thinks, how do you get good quality standardized data, which in some ways is more of a one-size-fits-all approach? Well, recognizing that fundamental lens of materiality means these factors play out quite differently in different sectors, and what that looks like is substantially different. And so how do you simultaneously hold that materiality lens, which fundamentally applies differently, but have a good baseline of solid data? And I left, you know, feeling a deep admiration for what they're trying to do, but an appreciation for the challenge of doing it.
Well, you know, if I could just respond to that, Matthew. So I think that, to your point, Mark, had it not been for Carbon Tracker, and I think other NGOs who are out there like CDP and others who are really trying to raise the bar in terms of the quality of information, information standards and standards of reporting, I don't know that the markets would necessarily have responded until it was perhaps too late, right? And so I do think that that is an important part of mobilizing the resources that we need, for instance, as a service provider, as an information organization, to be able to improve that information. But it's also about the engagement and the depth of the engagement on the issues, because these are actually two different poles of this question, right? So the TCFD is really pointing to issues that are much more qualitative and strategic in nature. They're talking about
the TCFD.
Oh, sorry, the task force. Sorry, this G20 work that right. we've been talking about. This is the Task Force on Climate-Related Financial Disclosures, and they just recently published their preliminary recommendations. But those recommendations are very much towards companies reporting and discussing around their strategy for dealing with climate change risk,
right.
And doing scenario analysis. And that requires a much deeper engagement than just the data, and then just using the data. If the data had not been improved to the point where you could use it to make those arguments, then it wouldn't have worked. But
right.
we have both poles now developing, I think.
What we are seeing from investment institutions and from pension funds is a bit of the who do we believe. So you got to remember, you remember the shareholder letter from Exxon to the investors saying we're going to burn everything. Everything's going to get burned. There are no stranded assets. Shell bent from Van Buren, the CEO, said just a couple of months ago, we're going to burn everything. There are no stranded reserves. And the chairman of Glencore, the coal company, said there are no stranded assets. We're going to burn everything. So the question for Wall Street firms and investment institutions is, do they believe the governments who signed the Paris Agreement? Do they believe citizens who want some kind of action? And even their clients, or do they believe the companies? And what the companies are saying is, oh, look, the world can't change, electric vehicles. So BP in their energy outlook for 2017 said that electric vehicles will be 6% in a couple of decades. Penetration of the vehicle market will be just 6%. And I think that's probably fundamentally wrong. I think in the same way that when the iPhone appeared, they didn't take a 5% market share from BlackBerry, they took 50% along with Samsung. They booted out BlackBerry. And I think what we're seeing in the energy transition is with the rise of electric vehicles is they're not going to take 5% or 6%. They're going to take a much, much significantly higher. And what that will do, it'll drive down demand for oil, and it will drive up demand for the electric vehicle. So why is BP telling their shareholders in Wall Street, why is Exxon? It's because they're fearful that when people in the industry, the fund management industry, cotton on to really what's going on and the speed of the transition, that actually they're going to start selling the stock and they're going to start challenging the valuation. And this is where this analysis and the data that Bloomberg produces and the advice that Goldman's gives is so important. Is there is a bit of a choice here. Do you believe that everything's going to go terribly slow? We're still going to be using huge amounts of coal in 2080. Even Chevron has renewable energy being in single digits of the energy mix in 80 years' time. Who do you believe? And I think they're
Yeah, that's interesting, because I interviewed Carney a year or so ago, and he very much was of the view that there will just be this moment where suddenly the market re-evaluates its valuation of all these carbon assets, and suddenly that will be the next big market crash correction happens.
So last month, $6 billion was raised in Wall Street for new oil and gas exploration. If you look at the return on capital for the oil and gas industry, and this is Bloomberg data, it's collapsed in the last 10 years, down to low single digits. But if you look at the stock price of some of these oil companies, they're going back through the roof, as if somehow. And Wall Street knows, Chevron and Exxon had profit warnings in the last few weeks. They're thinking that they're going to go back to this new normal. So the question that people have in their mind is this a cyclical thing? We've seen cycles. It goes up and down. Demand goes up and down. Or is this structural? Mm-hmm. Now, there is more important. I think there we believe that the change happening in the energy sector is a structural one. It's not cyclical. And then actually probably we're beginning to see the end of the fossil fuel age. And the real question for trustees is, do we allow the Shells and the Exxons to continue to spend tens of billions of dollars on shareholder funds to go and get more, go and discover more. And this is what they want us to believe. They want us to believe that the fossil fuel industry is expanding when actually it's contracting.
One of the interesting things that emerges from some of these conversations, and we've been working internally on this, is in some ways this starts to give a little renewed life to the world of active management, right? Which is right. These are complicated, research-driven. I heard someone clap. I'm glad if I made one active fund manager happy today.
Room for that.
No, but I think if you actually follow the thread, right? This idea of this is fundamentally research-driven. Companies will take different postures. You know, there are different risks, there are different ways to evaluate. Who do you believe? That sounds a lot more like fundamental research than it sounds like indexing. And I think it's a very interesting question. I think as we've worked closely with a lot of our more fundamental analysts, I mean, that's what comes up. It's a much more vibrant, dynamic conversation. And back to Divest, Invest, some of these sort of screened indices and other things are sort of interesting gateway drugs. But at the end of the day, it kind of gets back to a more research-driven, nuanced approach. And I think, you know, In the year and change since acquisition, I've probably talked to 450 of the largest institutional and private clients of the firm. And I come away with that both inspired by the demand, interest, and engagement. It's remarkable in a way that, frankly, I never could see at our little 16-person company, because those people wouldn't have met with us. But I have a fear, and that fear is not greenwashing. Because we were talking in the prep call about the panel, I said, I'm not worried about greenwashing. I'm worried about checklist washing.
Right.
Right? Because the pressure from asset owners and from the world to show demonstrably you are doing ESG. We're doing this. And Erica and I were talking earlier, and I wrote down a couple of Erica's quotes because I, you know, false precision is dangerous, right? This idea that at the end of the day, it's easier to have checklists, it's easier to have a third-party data provider that puts a stamp on something to say you're doing it. The real process is messy, complicated, evolving, hard, and nuanced. And for organizations often built around scale and systemization and templates, you know, when we joined, right, they said, well, where's your template? We said, actually, it's kind of an interview guide because it's a conversation, because investment strategies are different, market conditions are different. And so what I'm nervous about is there's a natural tendency towards checklist washing as opposed to the real fundamental investment question, which is harder and messier and murkier. And what makes it dangerous is checklist washing doesn't feel like anyone doing anything with ill intent. And it's not. No one's trying to do anything wrong. They think they're doing the right thing. And so, you know, it's a subtler danger to this. But I think that, for me, is the realer danger rather than greenwashing.
So I want to switch our focus a little bit to say, OK, we've heard a lot of quite positive things about what's going on in this climate finance area. What can we learn from that as we think about how to mainstream the rest of impact investing? And I wonder if we could start with green bonds, because, I mean, that's a phenomenal mainstreaming story, and $93 billion up from nothing 3 or 4 years ago. What happened to make that take off? And I mean, one thing obviously is the simplicity, and maybe that's a problem. But I mean, as we try and think about the rest of impact investing and how we mainstream it.
Yeah, so actually, I'm going to take the other side of John's argument about checklist watching, because I actually do think it is relevant for the conversation about green bonds and mainstreaming in general. I mean, I think that the investment management industry and portfolio management in general is sort of divided into two parts of the discipline, right? There's the technical side of the discipline, and then there is what you might call the art of portfolio management, right? So, but the technical side of the discipline has always been driven by checklists and credit templates. And, you know, as somebody earlier was talking about making decisions, you know, or Dan Hansen was talking about how you wouldn't go to investment committee and say, well, that investment I've made on the basis of PE or the price to book ratio, but we still do need that information as the basis. And so what happened in the green bonds industry, to go back to that, is that a template emerged and expectations emerged on the back of that template that helped the institutions and the market understand what market participants who were sort of on the leading edge of this wanted from them. So the green bonds principles is a really good example of how institutions actually need to step into this and raise the bar in terms of what is expected expected of underwriters in particular and issuers in terms of what they're communicating to the market about how they're going to use that money, not just how they're going to use the money when they issue the bond and they take the money and do whatever with it, but that they continue to communicate with markets and investors and market participants about the impact of the capital. And so I think that, you know, the checklist world, the framework world, the templates, all of these things are an exceptionally important foundation for mainstreaming and building these markets, because this is, let's face it, this is all extra stuff that we're asking. You know, it is still now. Yes, I want to live in a world where there are no green bonds and only bonds that are all green. But the fact is that, you know, we're still asking investment managers to do something that they're not yet used to. So
two follow-up questions. One is, you know, it seemed from your earlier comments that there's real question marks about whether there's additionality with these green bonds. Is there any additional money going into sustainable investing as a result of this $93 billion? And what's being done to make sure there is?
I think that there absolutely is. I mean, I think for the number of conversations that we have had, and again, you know, this is sort of the deeper, messier part that we don't hear about how having a vehicle that is intentionally designed to mobilize capital for sustainability activities has allowed organizations to, for instance, change their queuing and their capital budgeting so that they can advance investments in sustainability that they might perhaps have deferred because their NPV models, you know, didn't look good enough if they just tried to, you know, integrate it into their mainstream capital budget. So I do think that there is money that is being, you know, there's money that is being sort of reorganized temporarily as a result of these vehicles. And I do think that it is this kind of really mainstream financial instrument is helping money come in and ask for these instruments and the funds and the vehicles that John is that John's talking about.
And then the other question is, are there any promising sort of experiments going on in other forms of bond that could pursue other kinds of impact besides green?
Yeah, actually, we've been working very hard to sort of think about how we can not only raise the visibility of green bonds, but also social bonds and bonds that have mixed sustainability uses, but still leveraging this idea that it's a very mainstream vehicle that everyone understands. And that's when, again, things get a little bit more challenging and they get more messy, right? Because when you start talking about social impact, then, you know, we start engaging in this sort of relativism, this question about, you know, well, that's socially responsible enough for me, or that particular bond that is focused on healthcare, that's social enough for me to do healthcare. I don't need to know that it is, you know, that those proceeds are being directed towards a specific organization or a disadvantaged group or a marginalized segment of the population. So we have actually been trying to push back on that as Bloomberg through our standards for what we will pick up, for instance, as a social bond, and really trying to emphasize disadvantaged populations, marginalized segments of the population, et cetera. I don't think that that is something that is broadly embraced yet in the market and among underwriters, but I do think that is those are the kinds of sort of micro pushes that we all need to make as institutions.
Now, Mark, how do you see the carbon tracker approach being applied to other areas where there are impacts?
So carbon tracker, Cover my colleagues, partnered with Ceres in producing a report called the Clean Trillion. We're going to need $1 trillion a year over the next 20 to 30 years to create the green infrastructure that we need to make this energy transition. And one of the things that's come out of this event, and I've been listening, and I think Franz Siegel was speaking about this in an earlier session, was the importance of partnerships between the public sector and the private sector, blending public capital and private capital. I see the scaling up that we need to do in the clean energy space. The partnership, the European Investment Bank created something called GRIF, the Global Energy Renewable Energy Efficiency Fund, which was a $300-400 million fund. It's now raised new capital from private investors. I think Catholic Super from Australia put in $40 million, and it's now beginning to put in private capital, blending with public capital. We're going to need to see an awful lot more of those types of initiatives.
But what about areas where you could apply the kind of measurement math, simple math that you did with Carbon Tracker. Are there other areas?
Oh, okay. Well, well, if you think of the analytics, one of the things that's concerned me, and it's a really the question really broadly of capital markets as a whole, capital markets are very efficient at liquidating natural capital and converting it into financial capital. It's just obviously true. And the next initiative after Carbon Tracker, which is just, I just got some support from a Swiss foundation called Marva Foundation to launch Fish Tracker, which doesn't track fish, it tracks all the publicly traded companies involved in industrial fishing. And it came about when I discovered a Chinese fisheries business listed on the London Stock Exchange. And I've asked my environmental friends and my SRI friends, what do they think of this Chinese fisheries business? And they said, well, if there was one on the London Stock Exchange, we would all know about it by now. And then I showed them it, and they came as a real shock that we finance business, when I say we, capital markets finance businesses involved in the exploitation of resources, whether it's palm oil in Asia, industrial fisheries around the world. And by the way, our initial search, we found between 300 and 400 pure play wild catch fisheries businesses listed on stock exchange, which is a couple hundred more than I imagined. And we're in the moment doing that deep dive. And we can apply the same analysis to agriculture. It's amazing looking at these chairman's reports of these fisheries and agricultural businesses. Each chairman says, our goal next year is to grow by another 20%. Now, that may be true of one company individually, or maybe even a dozen, but couldn't it be true of all 300 companies? Can they all grow by 20%? Can these agricultural businesses doing palm oil, can they all grow 20% more palm oil next year? Well, to do that, they're going to have to deforest vast areas of the planet, and they're going to have to do some more overfishing. And what we haven't been good at as analysts in the sustainability spaces is really understanding the process of how capital markets function that do these things. And we need to dig deeper, and I certainly hope to be doing that in the coming year.
So, and I mean, you were obviously involved in setting up the Social Stock Exchange in London, but it sounds like you're thinking about stock exchanges and their roles is evolving as well.
Capital markets, debt and equity markets, and there's a bit of a yin-yang in my life. So Social Stock Exchange has been a place where you can list social impact bonds. It's actually a live market where you could emit companies, and there's now 40 companies there. And what it's trying to do is create kind of a concentration, a place where businesses that are B Corps or impact rated, and I'm on the admissions team to Social Stock Exchange, is where companies can set up their social mission, health and education, and then the retail public and the institutional investor can come in together in the same deal. And then there's another part of me which tries to unravel kind of the bad stuff and what can we do to address it. Yeah, well, it's research at the end of the day. It's analysis.
Divest, invest.
John, you've obviously, in your impact investing career, look at many more things besides what's going on in climate. But what lessons do you learn from how the climate finance area has gone much more mainstream?
Yeah, I think there are a couple of things. And some of them are, I think, from things that didn't work as well in climate finance. Right. So, for example, when we work with some large public pensions, you know, some of them work to do deeply thematically tilted public equity portfolios around climate. And many of those did not turn out well. I mean, one was created that was benchmarked to a dedicated climate change index, and it performed admirably relative to that index, but that underperformed their policy benchmark by 600 basis points a year. Right. And so this idea of use the right tool for the job in a way that people can understand, track, and hopefully achieve the progress they want, that lets it become a proof point as opposed to a cautionary tale. And I think we've seen that in these. And so, you know, green bonds versus thematically tilted equities. Green bonds you can fit into a conventionally structured portfolio. The deeply thematic tilts that are taking sector and style bets, much harder to do. And so this idea of the right tool for the right job. And I think we've mentioned this, but very little has been talked on this panel about. One of the things that is missing in climate finance, back to the clean trillion, is, you know, let's look at the invest part, particularly in the private assets, right? Let's look at doing the private equity, the real assets, the private credit, where there are core financial drivers, impact drivers that let you have more of a direct impact, primary capital into projects, into companies that are making an impact. I think this idea, what we can learn from climate finance is you find ways to get started, you find the right tool for the job, but don't stop with the entry points, right? That's the starting point. And follow the tape where it leads you. So back to climate finance, green bonds, we start getting calls from companies that have issued green bonds saying, the treasurer say, wait a second, should I green my cash? Right? This idea, if you find good entry points, follow the thread where it takes you. And I think that's it's a useful lens that we can take to some of the other sectors.
I actually wanted to ask Jan Piercy, who's here. Because we've been talking about climate finance as one area which you can learn from, but what about the whole community development finance, microfinance area? Are there lessons from that for the broader impact field? So there's a mic coming to you.
Absolutely, and Laurie Spangler, who's the CEO of Include, is here as well. And I would say, I loved your term, John, greening your cash, because there is a young millennial-started entity called Mighty, and it is inviting millennials to look at where they bank and saying, do you know where your money spends the night? Because it doesn't sleep. And indeed, there is a movement. And the beautiful thing, one of the beautiful things about this is that you don't have to be wealthy. Everyone or generally has a bank account or in some way does financial transactions. Some would say banks are obsolete. I don't think so. But that, so I think this is a really important sector to look at. And just one other thing I'd say, there is now an international association called the Global Alliance for Banking on Values. And you probably haven't heard of it yet because it purposely flew below the radar. It's a group of CEOs of financial institutions of a variety of types. Some are banks, some are credit unions, some are co-ops. And they ask themselves the question, we're financial institutions in very different economies and countries and local regulations alter. Could we come up with agreement around a set of principles that would be core to our business about sustainability? They achieved that. Having achieved that last year, they did get a CEO. They're growing very rapidly. They're all over the world. And they've now fielded a fund to invest in financial institutions that will commit to sustainability principles anywhere. So I think a lot is going on. I don't think it is as well known. So thank you for drawing that out.
Vivina Berles, Ron Asset Management. What I would love to hear from the panel is climate change has been focusing primarily on alternative energy and divest, invest, and a rather narrow sector of the challenge and the problem in front of us. Can you please forecast how long it will take for asset managers, investors, the industry, the people who care to actually come up with what else could we do to address the broader issue of climate change? Thank you.
And any other comments or questions before we go back to the panel? Food, yeah, okay. So I want to ask the panel to respond to those two comments and then wrap up by giving us a sense of, like, is there one, you know, what's the priority for the next 12 months that, you know, as we think about how to accelerate the climate finance aspect of impact investing? John?
So I'll maybe say that and then maybe just a quick word on your question. I think for where we sit, it's this sort of interesting combination of, in some ways, stuff that feels, you know, classic imprint and distinctive to what's available at the Goldman platform, which is use client, those edgier clients to push R&D, develop new products, fill market gaps, go deeper through the asset class spectrum, and then use the plumbing to scale it, right? And I think that's been the work to date, and I think as we think about what we can do, you know, that's what we can do. We have the folks that have us go create a new low carbon bond product and then plug it into the systems and scale. And I think that process across asset classes, I think that's what I see we can do, because then that gives A, more easier ways to access it, because that's what can seed retail products, all those other various things that can get distributed and builds models of success. I think to the question about what it will take to sort of fully embrace the question, I mean, not to get back to the checklist washing, but I think it is that all these things are an entry point, right? It gets to the broader, more holistic conversation of what else is there to do? How else can this help me manage my portfolio, manage risk reward, truly understand this, which is not just as simple as don't own a few of these securities and make a couple positive investments. And so what I encourage everyone is do the messier, harder work to use that as the beginning and not the end of the process.
Mark? Yeah, okay, so what's on my mind right now, the challenge of the coming year, I think there's some, I like this phrase greenwashing, but I want to apply it to what I see as corporate schizophrenia. You've got financial institutions that have some terrific statements on sustainability and ESG, but still plow ahead and fund the Dakota Pipeline and don't see that as contradictory. And at the same time, they will publish statements about transparency and the importance of taking climate risk under the board. But whenever there is a shareholder resolution, they vote down those resolutions. That's a schizophrenic position which cannot make any sense. What I see happening in the coming year is that divestment campaigners and others who are concerned about this are going to look at all the big asset managers, and you're going to have your Vanguards and your State Streets and your Black Rocks, and people are going to look at, say, State Street, who's been supporting these climate resolutions with big passive managers, and say, why should we have our passive money at an institution that always votes down these resolutions? Let's just move it to State Street, because we know they, as a house, as an institution, they're committed to doing the right thing. So I think probably the foundations, and there's a lot of foundations who have the money with institutions that always vote down these climate resolutions, the foundations and those here and people that advise them have got to ask themselves, we may not want to screen the portfolio for whatever reason, but let's make sure that we're with an institution that is consistently taking the right approach on these issues.
And you think that will be a campaigning issue?
It's going to be an issue. I mean, I don't want to be unfair to BlackRock, and they had their reasons, but on the same week that they published that they support transparency and accountability of the board on climate, it was announced that that they voted down a whole bunch of resolutions on precisely this question. Now, I'm being unfair to them because there was reasons behind that, but people are going to look at that and compare them to, say, State Street, who supported the resolution, say, hey, come on a minute. If one is charging 2 basis points and the other is charging 2 basis points and it's the same product, let's just move our assets to the institution that takes the right approach.
Lastly, Laura.
So I would pick up on the question both about how we broaden and ag and look at other sectors, because I think it's still relatively easy for us to sit up here and talk about, for instance, the energy sector, but whether it's energy, industrials, materials, utilities, we all already know that those are the organizations that are really at the core of the problem we're talking about with climate change. But we do need to broaden to other sectors, and I think ag and transportation and real estate, those conversations are still in relatively early stage. And I would pick up on what John said around materiality earlier, because I think that is what we at Bloomberg are looking for, you know, in coming years, is to see more material information disclosed by companies, more guidance from institutions like Carbon Tracker, for instance, on how and SASB on how they should be reporting in this information, not just in the form of data that analysts can use, with guidance from the Sustainability Accounting Standards Board, but also to speak to these harder questions around strategy and scenario analysis and management and governance. So we are really looking for the nature of the information that's being provided to go beyond sort of the puppies and unicorns kind of report to something that an active manager can actually use across sectors, not just in these big polluting sectors.